Welcome everybody to this webinar about our VSOC, the Vehicle Security Operations Center. So this is actually the third webinar in this series. So far we already discussed about the IDPS system in total as the immune system for the connected fleet. We discussed about the distributed IDS and just I think it was 2 weeks ago. Today we do something really new. We go outside of the car. Now we leave the car and we really look to what's happening behind the scenes in a vehicle security operations center. And I'm very much pleased that with Jens and Florian, I can give you all the details about that. So maybe let's shortly have a look who is actually today your expert. So my name is Jan. So I'm lead product manager for intrusion detection and prevention solutions at Ascript. I'm located actually in Stuttgart, so next to our mother company ETAS. And I'm in the automotive security now since a little bit more than 10 years. So started really with CAN bus and how to hack the CAN bus in 2009 and some research project on that. I stayed in the automotive security and more general IoT security for almost 10 years since 2013 with Ascript in multiple roles. And eventually I started to be product manager for our CAN IDS as well, now being responsible for the product family, which is called the IDPS. And today I'm happy that with me there is Jens. So Jens is senior product manager for our vehicle security operations center. So everything which happens outside of the car, I would say. And we will learn a lot about that from Jens today. And he's really into product security, I can tell you. And if you have seen some of the fundamental works on product security, especially from our mother company Bosch, then you most likely have read something from Jens and his 14 years of automotive security expertise. And finally, we have Jens with us, who's really our technical guy in the software architecture of CycurGUARD today, and to really show us behind the scenes what's behind happening with all your events. And also he's now more than 6 years in automotive security expertise. So I think quite a considerable team today for you. And we are all part of Ascript. So in Ascript, just for those of you who are first time with us, is a subsidiary of or is part of the Bosch group, and we started the topic of automotive security back in 2004. So we were really pioneering this topic, and today we have more than 400 employees in that area in 19 locations. So basically everywhere where you find automotive industry, you will also find Ascript. So now let's move into our today's presentation. And what we have prepared as an agenda for you is a very short, I would say, introduction and motivation. If you want to learn more about the motivation of IDPS in total, I really recommend you to look into the recordings of our first webinar, because we really here did a huge summary also about legal motivations on a global scale, also with a special look to the Chinese market. So I think that's really more in detail there. But today we keep it really short and just as a teaser more or less. Then we will see a technical overview on the Vehicle Security Operations Center. So what's behind that very long term, actually? What can you think about it if you heard that? Before we then make another deep dive into that and look, okay, what's inside of a Vehicle Security Operations Center technically wise, and especially here we look to CycurGUARD, which makes, I would say, a normal SOC, a VSOC kind of from a technical perspective, but more from that from Florian. And then, for sure, we'll have a conclusion and an outlook because there's also one more webinar coming, and I would say the thing I'm looking forward the most is number 5 Q&A. So we are really happy to receive your questions in the chat during the presentation and after the presentation, and hopefully we can provide you good answers to your questions. Good. So let's do this introduction and motivation very briefly. As I mentioned, just one motivational slide. You can already, thank you, Jens, bring it up. Yes. So what is really driving, I would say, the automotive security market in total currently is, beside all good technical arguments, which are there if you're into automotive security, is really the UNECE regulations, the UNR 155, and partially also the UN regulation 156. So why is that? So the UNECE regulation, which was adopted in summer 2020, is the first time that there is a worldwide harmonized cybersecurity legislation ongoing. And how does this work? Basically, the UN regulation tells you what you need to do a vehicle type approval in one country, which is part of that team of countries, which you see here in green on the map, to be able to get an easy type approval in all the other countries. Yeah? So it really eases the life of the OEMs by getting type approvals. And therefore, whatever is stated in this UN regulations has a direct impact for the global OEMs. Yeah, and what is part of this UNECE regulation is really four different disciplines. So you're really asked to manage vehicle cybersecurity. That means really, you need to have a cybersecurity risk management do this also. On a let's say lifecycle scale, and manage those risks, including the integration of the management, in this risk management on a really company-wide level. And then there is securing the vehicles by design to really get the security into the vehicles from the very first beginning, which is for me as a security guy very important, because you will not do security in the last sprint. If we talk in agile development, you really need to do it fundamentally from the beginning. And I'm very much happy that that approach is now also part of this regulation here. And then fourth, there is information on how to make secure software updates. Yeah, so vehicles become more and more dynamic. They get software updates over the air. And for sure, those updates needs to be really secure, meaning they need to be authentic. And also sometimes confidentiality is a topic. Definitely, they need to be unchanged. So integrity is needed. And for that, all the requirements are there as well, and more detailed than even in the R150. At 156, which is really on this over-the-air capability. Yeah, and then there is a third or fourth, but here's the number three, a discipline, which is about the detection and responding to security incidents across the vehicle fleet. And this is really what we will talk about today. So what do you need to do to be compatible here, or to basically fulfill that? And that is very important to look into, because time is running fast here. And we will see that actually this UNECE regulation is already applied for new vehicle types in July 2022. And then it will be also applied for 2024 for existing vehicle types. So therefore, I would say in automotive development cycles, this is like really tomorrow, or I would even say yesterday, because that's really, really soon. All right, let's look one step deeper here. And we will just have this as a teaser. I would say I really recommend you to have a look into our first webinar. So is that really needed from a legislation point of view? And I would like to start here really with the bottom line. So IDPS and VSOC is not explicitly required in the UNR 155. So it's not written there. You need exactly to have this. And unfortunately, they also haven't read noted down our product names. No, that is not the case. But if you look into the requirements, and if you take the requirements seriously, it's very, very hard to fulfill without. So, and here's just some of the sites from the UN regulation. So, like really being able to detect and monitor the attacks using in-vehicle IDS sensors, detect and prevent cyber attacks against vehicles of the vehicle type to the left, that side, or also to the right-hand side. You see from the annex very concrete measures, for example, to detect internal messages. This is even, if you look into the document, more concrete there. They even talk about malicious CAN messages there. So they are very specific in the technologies which you need to apply to get this done. So if you find a good lawyer, I would say you may get around it. But let's say if you're really into the technical details, and if you really take this serious, I would say you need an approach for an IDPS, including a VSOC. But that's legal. Let's come to the technical part here. As an overview for today, I would like to show you basically the elements we are talking about. So as you can see from the left to the right, so we distinguish network intrusion detection systems, so systems which are in the car to monitor the in-vehicle communication, may it be CAN or may it be Ethernet, for anomalies. And then it tells us that there's some fishy thing ongoing, which might be an attack. We talk about host-based IDS systems which are monitoring a specific host. In our case, it's an ECU, and we detect that somebody is attacking this particular ECU. And we combine all this information from host-based IDS sensors and network IDS sensors within distribution framework. This is exactly what we talked about in our last webinar on CycurIDSM and CycurIDSR, so the manager and reporting component in a car. And then we have basically a good picture of what is happening in this one car, but we don't have the picture of what is happening in our vehicle fleet. And that is basically exactly what we want to achieve today. So sending the data offboard from the IDSR to the VSOC, that's basically the step which is now next. And so therefore, we will today focus really on the Vehicle Security Operations Center and what's inside. So what does the Vehicle Security Operations Center bring as a value to you? And how does it do that? And I'm more than happy to hand here over to Jens and Florian, which will guide us in this journey.
Thanks, Jan, for this question. So what actually is a Vehicle Security Operations Center, or VSOC, as we say for short, and what value does it bring to us? So first, vehicle VSOC, the task is mainly to monitor data from vehicles and vehicle-related backend systems. And the goal herein is to detect cybersecurity incidents. This means incidents that affect the security status of the vehicle fleet. And I want to show in five layers the value that a VSOC brings to us. Jan has already introduced our in-vehicle IDS sensors. So the first layer is here, the evaluation of reports from our in-vehicle IDS sensors and make the information understandable on what they report. Secondly, we can incorporate additional data into this picture. These are data collected by OEMs already in the backend. This can be data about IT systems involved in the management of vehicle fleets. For example, this means that I can add context to the reports that I see, but on the other hand, it can also reveal security incidents itself. For example, attacks that target to backend systems. Third layer is to correlate events across the fleet. In this way, I'm able not only to distinguish whether an incident affects only one single vehicle or a larger number of vehicles, and maybe to identify the commonalities of those vehicles which are affected by an attack. Fourth, we correlate events over time. This means we can take past events into account, and in this way we can detect evolving attacks, and we can, for example, link the different elements of one attack chain as it belongs together. And fifth, we observe threat intelligence. What does this mean? It includes the monitoring of industry-wide, domain-wide known attack vectors, it also includes the anonymized exchange of detections across products and customers. And in this way, we are in the position to detect cybersecurity incidents, to explain them, and to provide actionable information on what has to be done. And this is what we call situational awareness. So as a summary of this slide, Vehicle Security Operations Center provides us with a situational awareness on the security status of a vehicle fleet. So now I want to take a different view. How does a VSOC integrate into the customer's infrastructure and into its processes? So if we read this picture from the upper left corner, we see here the inputs for our VSOC. The possible data sources are fleet backend data. For example, telematics data that are already collected today by OEMs. It also includes our IDS reports that are collected from the vehicle fleets, so from our IDS sensors. We see here vehicle databases. For example, they give information on the car service visits and the software status of the components in the vehicle. And we also see here IT systems. For example, these are systems related to the fleet management, like software update systems, or those systems which are involved when I have an app that allows me to open my car. And data from all these data sources can be onboarded into the VSOC for security monitoring. Typically, we select data, so we onboard logs, alerts, maybe in some cases also raw data, in order to get a good picture on what is happening. On the right-hand side, we see the output of a VSOC. This is, in essence, a security incident report that tells us if an incident has happened, which gives us additional explanation. So this means, for example, that it aggregates all events that belong to a common incident. It gives context and explanation. And it also makes sure that we do not see false positives. And the goal herein is to provide a human readable incident report with comprehensive information on an incident to put the incident responder in a good position to decide on next steps. The incident report is then handed over or taken up by the OEM incident response process. There it has to be decided whether action has to be taken, which are steps to be taken, and to implement these response steps. And the VSOC is now shown here in this green box in the middle of this picture. And it is responsible for the continuous processing of the input data in order to reliably produce incident reports when a cybersecurity incident happens. And so this green box, we now want to take a closer look at this. And what we provide as Ascript is our offer. What is our offering? Our VSOC provides an operation of this infrastructure for the continuous processing of data. And if we now take a closer look into this green box, we see that it consists of three main elements. And to explain this, we have to see that security operation centers are already around for the IT, enterprise IT, since more than 20 years. So SOCs are an established concept, and they are set to contain of three main elements of platform, processes, and people. Platform for the processing and analysis of data, and also to support automation. Processes to make sure that data are processed in a reliable manner and that accurate incident reports are produced. This includes also clear responsibilities and the processing according to a defined and documented plan. And lastly, we see here people. That means security analysts and incident responders, which are available for a manual analysis of data and incidents make sure that the incident reports have a good quality. And now in the next slides, I would like to take a look at each of these components individually. And I start with a look on the VSOC platform. So we distinguish here two main components in the VSOC platform. That is first CycurGUARD. That's our name for our onboarding service for fleet and vehicle data. This is kind of the automotive specific part of our solution. And secondly, we see here the SOC platform, which describes here the less domain-specific parts of our solution. It includes the toolings that are available and used also for IT SOCs, and where we have basically established tools and tool chains available. To look more into the details, we see here that the role of CycurGUARD is to accept, to onboard, accept, and normalize the incoming data. It is has the ability to pull data from databases to add additional context to this onboarded data and to bring them into a format that makes them ready to be processed by a standard SOC platform. In this sense, the CycurGUARD makes the incoming data SOC ready. The SOC platform in the lower part of this picture, at its core, it has a component called CIEM, which stands for Security Information and Event Management System. And the CIEM is a standard component for aggregating and correlating log data. It can, for example, it allows to generate alerts according to defined queries. It allows forensic analysis. And CIEM, there are standard tools available for CIEM, and this kind of is here at the core of our SOC platform. But we also see that for an efficient an analytics, we also need additional components and tools around this CIEM core to enable, for example, machine learning and advanced analysis capabilities. And we also see here in our picture additional tools that enable and support the interaction between security analysts and the platform to make the life as easy for them as possible. And we see that one main channel of communication between the VSOC and the customer is here a ticketing system, which is there for the management and processing of security incident reports. So it's an audit-proof solution in order to process the security incident reports, and also to it allows interplay between our VSOC analysts and the incident response responsibles on the customer side on single security incident reports until the ticket can be finally resolved. So our default offering here is a cloud-based service, a cloud-based platform. And we also see here for the standard SOC part, we rely on partnering with a leading provider of security operation center services who does this already for a long time in for the enterprise IT case. And so the idea is here to rely on, to not reinvent the wheel and rely on an proven bulletproof and battle-proven technology that's already established and used in other cases. So CycurGUARD is an important part in our picture, but we will come to this at the later stage in our presentation today. So on the next slide, I would like to take a closer look into the SOC platform and look at how data are processed in our SOC platform. And if we now look at this picture and look at the left-hand side, we see again the possible data sources, and we distinguish here two main classes of data. These are first the fleet data, which are kind of the automotive specific data. We talked about them before, in-car IDS sensor reports, data from vehicle databases, telematics data. These are in our picture pre-processed by CycurGUARD to make them SOC ready, as I said. And then we also see on the other hand, the enterprise IT data. And here, we have kind of while the automotive application and automotive domain for SOCs is quite new, enterprise IT is an established domain. So we have established SOC use cases for this type of data, and they are established and well supported log sources. And some examples are named here. So system logs, network traces, proxy logs, and reports from endpoint monitoring solutions. These are some examples. And now these logs, alerts, traces are onboarded, and we have they are fed into a joint data pipeline where fleet data and enterprise data are processed together in one picture. So we see here at the in the first stage the CM in place for aggregation and correlation of data. It can, for example, give us the possibility to already aggregate all events that or many events that belong to a common root cause. It allows, for example, build relations between data from different sources. For example, if I have data about my vehicle, about the software status queried from a component in my vehicle, and I can compare it to the information that's stored in a database on the authorized software updates rolled out to my vehicle and check whether this information matches. Beyond the CM, I mean, the CM already comes with some onboard capabilities for analysis, but we add additional tools around the CM to enhance these analytics capabilities to support also machine learning and statistical analysis of data. And this can be, for example, then used to reduce false positives and to provide pre-assignment of pre-classification of data and a pre-assignment of incident criticality and incident type to make the life for security analysts easier. So they can focus on looking at the critical events first. And nevertheless, we see here the human factor in our picture, the security analysts, and they want to perform investigations. They want to do threat hunting for maybe suspicious events. And the analyst workbench supports the security analysts in their tasks such that they can focus on what really matters. So the main message that I want to give here in this picture that a common IT, common data pipeline is in place where fleet and enterprise data are processed in one pipeline. After I've been talking about a platform now, I come now to the second component of our high-level VSOC picture, which are the processes. So processes should ensure that a VSOC processes data in a reliable manner. And for me, from my point of view, so-called VSOC use cases are a main driver for the VSOC processes. And let me start to explain what a VSOC use case is. So I need to, of course, to decide on which data sources and which data do I onboard onto the VSOC for the sake of monitoring. What are my detection goals when I do this? And how do I want to process this data in my platform? And what detection and rating criteria do I apply? So these are parts of the specifications of VSOC use case. And now, of course, VSOC use cases are not should not be something static that are built up once, but it should be it necessarily has to be a continuous process to regularly review and update and advance the set of VSOC use cases that I'm working with. This means I, on a regular basis, review my data sources, my detection goals, my processing logic, and my rating criteria. And I also test the VSOC use cases and monitor their performance in order to decide whether I'm still happy with the set of use cases that I have or whether something has to be adapted. And for this, I also have supporting processes like regular performance reviews with the customer to decide on whether we really see the right things that we want to see. We do incident report improvement, so post-analysis of previous incident reports and the actions that have been taken. We, in particular, post-process false positives, so security incident reports which turn out to be a false positive, since ideally we want to make sure that we see them once, but we do not see them as a false positive for a second time. And last here in this list, we look at automotive threat intelligence data in order to decide whether there are newly occurring threat vectors around that make it necessary to update or align our VSOC use cases. So all these supporting processes can be taken as an trigger to make changes to our set of VSOC use cases. So after I've been talking now about platform and processes, I come now to the last component in my high-level picture, which are people. And I want to introduce here three different roles in our VSOC picture that are essential for an efficient operation of a VSOC and a high-quality operation. First, we look at VSOC security analysts. They are available 24/7 on a 24/7 basis, and their tasks include a manual processing and manual validation of events. They can add additional explanation and context to the events. If they see something suspicious, they can go into threat hunting and edit investigations. They also can support incident management activities on the customer side and give additional explanation to incident reports. The second role that I would like to introduce here is what we call VSOC engineers. This is kind of a second row of analysts, and their main task includes the monitoring optimization of VSOC use cases. That means to monitor whether new use cases should be proposed and introduced, whether existing use cases are still working efficiently. And this includes, for example, as I have said, evaluation of false positives and incident response feedback, and to look at current insights from cross-customer and industry-wide threat intelligence. And this leads us to the third category to our third role that I would like to introduce here. We have actually an automotive threat intelligence team in place, which engages in security news monitoring threat information in evaluation. They can also, for defined products, engage in product field monitoring and vulnerability monitoring. And they also, in particular, engage in community work. For example, we are part of Auto Isaac, which is an alliance, a global alliance on sharing of security, automotive security insights and knowledge. And we are also engaged, for example, in the developing of the automotive attack framework, which is kind of an automotive specific variant of the well-known Mitre attack framework. So now I have been talking about platform, I've been talking about processes and about people. And now I would like to wrap up and take you on a journey along an incident that happens and how it is processed in this VSOC picture. So we see here three swim lanes, on the top lane, the vehicle, in the middle lane, the VSOC, and on the lower lane, the activities on the OEM, on the customer side. And if we assume that an attacker tries to break into a vehicle, he will very likely try to do this via a wireless interface. One of the wireless interfaces try to get into the car. In many cases, this will be blocked by the car's security mechanisms. But at some point, he might be successful and find a vulnerability and be able to reach an in-car device and be able to run own code there in order to also send messages on the internal vehicle buses and networks. And for example, if he is sending now his own data onto the CAN bus, it will be detected by our CycurIDS, which is our component for detecting anomalies on the CAN bus. If something like this happens, there will be most likely be a number of incidents being produced by this. They are sent to the VSOC backend. The platform already reduces the number of incident events that we see here considerably by aggregating all this information that belongs together. And the security analyst then manually looks at this data and compiles them into a security incident report, and also does the communication with the incident response team on the customer side in order to manage this incident case. The customer can then take appropriate actions. Let's assume that, for example, the connectivity of the vehicles can be restricted in order to avoid that this vulnerability is re-exploited. In the background, the OEM can then develop a fix for a detected vulnerability, roll it out via software update, and then restore the full connectivity of his vehicle fleet. And the one main message here is to point out the complexity reduction that the VSOC brings into this picture. So we have done on the bottom a model calculation for an example security incident. We see the number of messages in a car, the number of events produced by our in-vehicle IDS sensor, and this is brought down already by the VSOC platform to 12 single events that an analyst has to look at, and the customer only sees then in the end one comprehensive report. So now I take one step back. I'm finished at the end of my presentation part. We have looked at platform processes and people. Have taken a closer look into the VSOC platform. We've talked about the SOC part, but not about the CycurGUARD part so far. So Florian Ziegler will present on this. Florian, what's behind CycurGUARD? Can you give us some details here?
Yes, thank you, Jens. So could you jump to the next slide, please? Yes. So we have seen on the earlier slides that there are two kinds of systems we want to connect to our VSOC. One side is the enterprise IT systems that more or less directly flow into our analytics backend. And the other type of data is the data that comes out of the automotive domain. So, and there's stark contrast between the enterprise IT domain and the automotive domain, because they operate in completely different principles. The enterprise IT domain and the security monitoring in the enterprise IT domain is a well-established ecosystem. It has been matured for many years. And this is a contrast to the automotive domain. This is an evolving ecosystem. Nobody has designed the vehicle, the data in the vehicle, the data in the backends, the fleet management, etc., for any kind of security monitoring. We have to take the data that is there, and most of this data is unstructured and also context sensitive. This is, again, in contrast to the enterprise IT domain, where the current CMS and analytics backends work best with structured data and self-contained data. Self-contained means here that the data that goes into the analytics backend already has all the necessary data that is necessary to fully understand the event. This is not the case for the events that come out of the vehicle. They need to be enriched. And also the enterprise IT domain works with standard formats, for example, the syslog format or other formats. This is a luxury we currently do not have in the automotive domain. There are a multitude of formats and variants of those formats. So there's a mismatch between the enterprise IT domain, the tools of which we are using and want to use to prevent reinventing the wheel, and the current state of affairs in the automotive domain. And here comes CycurGUARD into the picture. So CycurGUARD, as you see on the next slide, forms the link between the automotive domain and the enterprise IT domain. So together with CycurGUARD, we can create a VSOC that processes automotive data with established enterprise security technology. This comes with some challenges. Bridging both worlds has many interesting facets to it. And I show you a short overview on the next slide. So these are some selected challenges. The one on the left, first one sounds trivial, but it's actually a very complex one. We have to understand the variety and diversity of IDS sensor formats that are in the field. And not only the IDS sensor formats, but also other kinds of data that is currently available in the vehicle or outside of the vehicle. This is the second challenge, the data that is outside of the vehicle, the off-board data, for example, in fleet management backends, has to be added to the events to provide valuable context. And the third challenge I have selected for today is like bringing those data sources together. And this is like very detailed work to identify the labels, the identifiers, and other stuff that has to be normalized in order to efficiently work with multiple data sources that have never been designed with the intention in mind to use them together. So currently, these are multiple isolated data sources, and the challenge here is to get the data together into form, into shape, to actually use it for an analytical purpose. On the next slide, I will provide more detailed insight into this. And we currently do not think about it, but what we are building today has to work for the next decades. So vehicles that are out today that have IDS sensors in them and send data to us, those systems have to be maintained for the next couple of years. And so we cannot lean back and say, okay, we are a new field, we are a green field, we do whatever we want, whatever we need. We have to take in mind that there are formats and additional data sources and other stuff that we will have to access the next couple of years. What makes this problem worse is the fact that we are currently very low on standard formats. So we expect in the next couple of years, for the next couple of years, that there will be a proliferation of proprietary and heavily customized formats. Of course, there will be standard formats, but currently we do not have that luxury. So CycurGUARD plays an important role here to shield the enterprise IT domain, to shield the CM and analytics backends from the fact that they would continuously have to adapt to the data sources. And the next thing is the data that comes in is oftentimes so compressed, so lacking for detail, that sometimes we do not even know how to pass the data. So what formats are used, what variant of the format is used, this is all the thing that CycurGUARD can figure out. CycurGUARD knows what kind of software is running in the vehicle. CycurGUARD can query the fleet backend for additional information to figure out what data is coming in and how to parse it and how to make sense of it. So CycurGUARD manages the zoo of formats and the CM receives cleaned up and ready to analyze data. When we go to the bigger picture and leave the vehicle side for a moment and look at the backend systems. Connected vehicles leave data traces in all kinds of OEM backends, be it remote diagnostics or firmware over the air updates, or for electric vehicles, charging operations, there are all kinds of bits and pieces of information in fleet-related backends. And this data is instrumental to understand whether a report or an event that we receive from a vehicle is an actual attack or not. It makes a huge difference if a vehicle is currently in a garage undergoing maintenance or whether the vehicle is standing at the roadside. If the vehicle is in a garage and we receive events about diagnostic accesses, we know that this may be okay. If the vehicle is on the roadside, this may be an abnormality. And this is why we want to incorporate the data as early as possible and make it easy for the analytics backend to understand this data. And for this, again, we have to do very detailed work. There are different backends that have never been designed to work together. And now we have the task with CycurGUARD to identify where to link up those data sources. Which are the identifiers we have to normalize? In the one data source, it has the identifier 5. In the other one, it has the identifier 6. And now CycurGUARD unifies this so that the analytics backend works on a nice databases. This also applies for labels and values. So the bottom line is that CycurGUARD prepares a unified and consistent view of all data sources. So I now hand over to Ian for the conclusion and the outlook.
Hey, and Florian, thank you for guiding us to all this material and really giving us an overview on the value of a VSOC and what's happening behind the scenes, and also then a very technical view on the challenges which are, let's say, addressed by our CycurGUARD solution. Yeah. So let me be very brief here. So the threat landscape is continuously changing. That means there's a technical need for IDPS to be, let's say, at least on a level of the attacker, yeah, to monitor continuously, to know that something's happened to your fleet and be able to react. So really, from a technical point of view, you want to have such kind of a solution to stay in control. The regulations coming into place, so even, let's say, maybe if you cannot convince your management by talking about this technical topics, they will be very much convinced that there's legislation which simply says that's the truth. We need to look into such kind of solutions to be have a holistic solution for automotive security, which is really covering the whole vehicle lifecycle. And we as Ascript, we are more than happy to provide really here the complete package. We can really give you the in-vehicle components, we can give you the VSOC. You can also have the puzzle pieces and build yourself, but you can have the end-to-end service from us, and we are happy to offer that. So that's basically what we bring to the table, and I think you have seen what we have brought to the table today, quite some material, and I'm happy to receive your questions afterwards. But I would not like to miss here that there's another webinar coming, the last one, which will be about CycurGUARD, our Ethernet and IP firewall, and intrusion prevention systems. So what can be done actually already in a vehicle? So surely we have the feedback loop via the VSOC, as we learned today, but also there's things you can do actually in a vehicle. We would like to talk about this advanced technologies as well. Yeah, so again, please feel free to also look into the webinars which we have already presented to you, and also I would like to advocate a look into our white paper. So, and by that, we are at the end of our presentations, but hope you still enjoyed it and happy to answer your questions.